it's Fran. I'm in the lab again. Time for the tough questions. Just start right at the top. Pew Pew with Todd asks, pew 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 pew. I guess I was thinking about Todd. Okay. Hi, Fran. Do you think it's possible to have a star form entirely from water? For instance, a planet with the mass of a star, that's a water world. No, that wouldn't work. I guess to really answer the question, you'd have to talk about what is a star, how do they form, where do they come from, and what makes a star a star. Our star, our sun, is a third generation yellow dwarf main sequence star, which is ideal for us because it's like right in the middle of its lifespan, it's the right size. Yellow dwarfs are the most common stars in the observable universe, and they are very stable. And like I said, our star is a third generation star because our star and our solar system, all the planets, all the asteroids, everything in our solar system came out of a dust cloud, which was formed from the extinction of a very old second generation star, which blew up many billions of years ago and formed a sort of a molecular cloud that our solar system and our sun and planets and the Earth and you and I all kind of came out of the dust that formed into a disk called an accretion disk from that cloud. And the sun, our sun, like all stars, no matter how big they are, they're basically hydrogen balls of hydrogen that get large enough to create nuclear fusion just from the compression of all the gravity, all the weight of the hydrogen, and create helium from hydrogen. So my big ass drawing board here, we're going high tech. Look at this. This is high tech. I've got a big pad of paper taped to a block of foam. How about that? Yeah, baby. Going all the way. Spare no expense. So yeah, so the sun, you get hydrogen, right? And you compress to hydrogen under extreme pressures and you pop out a helium. And this process goes on for billions of years. Hydrogen into helium, that's how stars work. The gravitation of the mass of hydrogen creates a fusion in the core where it's super, super hot, millions of degrees, incredible pressures, and the hydrogen atoms are just forced together in the same space. The nuclei fuse and bing! You get helium and you get an ass load of photons and energy. All kinds of radiation. Basically the whole visible spectrum. You get X-rays, gamma rays, visible light, radio. You get the whole shebang out as energy from that fusion. And that's what stars do. In order for a star to be a star, you need this. You need hydrogen. In fact, when stars get old enough and the amount of helium begins to grow in the core of the star, star becomes very unstable. The star, like our own star, our sun, it is a balance of forces. But as the stars get older and they burn through their hydrogen fuel and they become more and more helium heavy, stars begin to lose their energy. They begin to cool down and they begin to expand. In fact, our star, our little calm little yellow dwarf star, when it exhausts its hydrogen, it will grow into a red giant. In fact, it will expand into this cooler, larger mass of gas, which will consume Mercury, Venus, and possibly even the Earth before it's done. And our star is not big enough to go supernova or become a black hole. It will exhaust its fuel and it will collapse into a cool blue dwarf star, probably, or a white dwarf. But you need the hydrogen, the molecular hydrogen, not bound to anything. In fact, larger stars, stars that are much more massive than our sun, they actually can burn much, much hotter. And over the course of their lifetime, they begin to produce heavier and heavier elements, not just helium, but they start to compress helium atoms together. They start to produce lithium, beryllium, boron, carbon. And there's sort of a limit. Even the very large stars, once they get contaminated with these kind of heavier elements, they become very unstable and they will go supernova. With super, super big stars, you get two things happening. First, the hydrogen and helium get blown into interstellar space, and the heavier core begins to collapse into a supernova. When a star goes supernova, if it's large, and we're talking about a star that's many times the size of our sun, right? When they finally exhaust their hydrogen fuel and collapse, a very sudden, very violent act occurs where all these heavier elements, the helium, lithium, beryllium, carbon, they get crushed into like this super crunch just before a massive explosion. And in that crunch and explosion, all kinds of elements get spewed out. That kind of a supernova will spew out elements like oxygen, iron, silicon, these heavier elements, all the way up to even uranium and plutonium in very small amounts. It depends on the kind of star. But the final crunch and explosion of these supermassive stars creates sort of the periodic table of elements that our solar system formed out of. It sort of puts a timetable in the universe, because it's not like planets suitable for life were around millions of years after the Big Bang, or have been existing in the universe for tens of billions of years, because this just wasn't possible. We needed several generations of stars to gradually build up heavier and heavier elements. The first stars were all hydrogen, supermassive hydrogen stars, some of which were so massive and burned so hot and so fast that they just collapsed in upon themselves and formed the supermassive black holes that are at the center of just about all of the galaxies in the cosmos. And second generation stars were pretty much the same. Hydrogen helium stars that, when they collapsed and exploded, had the opportunity to produce heavier elements, like the elements that make up our solar system. Water is pretty scarce, even in our solar system. If you take water into consideration of all the other elements, hydrogen, helium, iron, silicon, calcium, potassium, and hydrocarbons that form out of the hydrogen and carbon, that's kind of like the majority of what our solar system is made out of. The water and the oxygen, it's kind of tricky, because in order to make water, you need two things. You need molecular hydrogen, right? H2. It's two hydrogen atoms. And you need molecular oxygen, O2. It's two oxygen atoms. So not only do you need the oxygen, but you need to have molecular oxygen meet molecular hydrogen. If this is done like in cold temperatures, like in deep space where it's not going to be too hot, you're going to get most likely H2O2, hydrogen peroxide, which is highly reactive and unstable, and pretty much whatever H2O2 comes in contact with, the next thing it comes in contact with, it's going to react and it's going to disintegrate itself, and you're going to end up with an oxygen being spewed out and water. So if you have an environment where you have lots of molecular hydrogen, lots of molecular oxygen, you're going to get a lot of H2O2, and when that reacts, you're going to have water, and we get two H2O2s reacting, we get H2 water molecules, and we get an oxygen molecule. But the idea of having a huge, supersized planet, we're talking bigger than Jupiter. Jupiter is often called a failed star, but it's minuscule. And Jupiter is made up mostly of hydrogen and helium, just like a third generation star would be. It's got most likely a metallic core, metallic hydrogen. But this is really the majority of what the solar system is made out of. In fact, any solar system, the majority is going to be made out of hydrogen and helium. Almost all of it, by volume and weight, is going to be hydrogen and helium. In order to have something the size of the sun form, I just can't imagine what kind of natural circumstance would create so much oxygen to be available with so much hydrogen in one spot. And it wouldn't turn into a star if you could theoretically put a star's worth of water in one spot. It would just collapse upon itself and become a black hole. It wouldn't, it would be too heavy, you know, it would be too heavy. It wouldn't turn into a star. You wouldn't get nuclear fusion, I don't think. I think you would basically just get a small black hole. But yeah, I could be wrong about this. I'm not a chemist. I don't really know anything about chemistry. But I guess the short answer is no. It would never happen. You know, just don't have that much oxygen around. You know, oxygen is kind of rare. Even in our solar system, like the icy moons of Jupiter have a lot of water, but they're small. You know, they're small moons, even though they do have a lot of water on them. But you take all the water in our entire solar system, from every asteroid, every planet, everything, you're not going to get enough water to get anything nearly the size of like a decent planet, so much less a star. I'm not going to say it's impossible. Maybe it's happened somewhere in the galaxy or the universe at some point. But yeah, I don't think you'd end up with a star. I think you'd just end up with a black hole. Just go right to black hole. Niall Fleming, am I pronouncing your name right, Niall? Asks, is faster than light possible in our lifetime? Well, no, faster than light's not possible in anyone's lifetime. Nothing can go faster than light. There is a cosmic speed limit, the speed of light, and it cannot be exceeded by anything, period. You know, nothing with mass can travel at the speed of light, not even really like near the speed of light. In fact, even getting like a single particle of matter to go the speed of light is impossible. You can exhaust all the energy of our sun to get a single particle of matter up to 99.9999999% of the speed of light. But you can start consuming entire solar systems worth of energy, entire galaxies full of energy, and you're just going to be adding on nines onto that number. Keep adding nines, keep pushing the decimal places, but it's just, you can consume all of the energy in the universe, and you just keep adding on decimals, infinite decimals, but you'll never get that particle to the speed of light because nothing with mass can travel at the speed of light. It's a big board. All right. Yeah, so nothing can travel at the speed of light that has mass. Everyone knows it, right? Speed of light squared, c squared, that is the constant. It's not just a constant of speed, it's a constant of time. We live in space-time, that is three-dimensional space in time, space-time, time being the fourth dimension, or at least how we perceive the fourth dimension, and it's the constant in everything that has to do with the physical universe. The speed of light is always there. The amount of energy that you have in any kind of a system is equal to its mass times the speed of light squared. The more energy you put into a particle, you increase its mass proportionally. And you slow down its clock. If you move in three-dimensional space in any direction, you are moving into the fourth dimension. And that speed, whatever it is, slows down your clock. So the faster you go in any direction in three-dimensional space, you're adding energy to yourself and your spacecraft or whatever. As you add energy, you're also increasing your mass and you're slowing down your clock. But this is not infinite. You know, when you get to a certain point, it just requires more and more and more energy because you're getting to a point where you've got a curve going like this. and that curve is going to be approaching infinity, right? And you've got speed, and you got mass, and you have energy, and well, even though I drew that, these two lines can never meet. You will know, you know, this will get closer and closer and closer and closer and closer to the speed of light. This will be c, and this is your mass going infinitely up. The speed of light is here. These two lines will never meet. They'll just get closer and closer and closer as you're as you approach infinite mass. You get closer and closer to speed of light, and it's just your 99.999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999 also your clock is slowing down. So as you approach the speed of light, your clock is going down to zero. I'm going to do a video about electrons, which is very interesting, because a lot of people think of electrons moving at the speed of light, but that's, I'll do a whole video on that. But a photon can move at the speed of light, because a photon is massless. Is a photon a particle? Is it a wave? Well, it depends. when a photon is traveling the speed of light, it's not a particle. But you can slow photons down, and they can get mass if you slow them down below the speed of light. Electrons, too, because electrons do have mass, a small amount of mass, they can actually get to the speed of light as electrons. They can be converted into photons and other kinds of waves, which can go the speed of light. But anything going at the speed of light is out of time.
Ah, Jesus Christ.
A photon does not experience time at all. It is outside of space-time because it is traveling at the speed of light. Anything traveling at the speed of light is outside of space-time because our three-dimensional universe, length, width, right? Our three-dimensional length, width, height universe is hurtling into the fourth dimension at the speed of light. So we get time. But as we approach the speed of light, time slows down and we approach infinite mass. But nothing can go beyond this. Nothing with mass can go faster than the speed of light. In fact, nothing with mass can go near the speed of light. And it isn't a matter of warp drive, hyperspace, none of this stuff exists, as far as we know. But if you were to travel vast interstellar or intergalactic distances, you wouldn't be able to do it inside of three-dimensional space. It would not be possible, because there's a speed limit. You can, however, in theory, travel interdimensionally. You can forego all this entirely by simply getting the hell out of space. You know, you can, if you can manipulate higher dimensions, you can theoretically leave space-time in one spot and just pop in another without really moving anywhere. But that has nothing to do with this. But no, faster than light travel is by definition impossible. There isn't enough energy in the universe to even go the speed of light, much less faster. And that's because of this irrefutable law. You know, all the energy in the universe and all the mass in the universe could not get you to go to the speed of light. Very close, but not quite. And certainly not ever past it. You know. But I'm not a physicist. I really don't know anything about physics. So I could be completely wrong about that. If you're a physicist and you know better than me, then please, you know, make a video about faster than light travel. Martin Dennis Armellini Sarkeesian. Am I even remotely pronouncing your name right? Sorry, Martin Dennis, I'm probably way off. But Martin Dennis asks, are neutrinos, which bombard the Earth and rip through every piece of matter on this planet, a probable cause of cancer in humans? The short answer would be no. The long answer would be maybe. I say that because the correlation between radiation and cancer is not direct. You don't have radiation and then cancer. Because cancer is a disease, a very complex disease, and radiation is something which can lead to a chain of events which could lead to cancer. But there's lots of things in between. Important to realize that background radiation is a reality. Radiation from the sun, cosmic rays, radiation from the earth itself. I've done videos about background radiation. We are bombarded with radiation all the time. In fact, our bodies are themselves radioactive, measurably radioactive, because we contain a lot of radioactive isotopes of carbon, potassium, other elements. Lots of elements have radioactive isotopes, and with all the trillions of atoms that make up the human body, you know, we accumulate a certain number of them, and some of the elements that we depend on, like potassium, have a fairly, you know, decent number of radioactive isotopes, and you know, we irradiate based on that. You can't avoid radiation, even in your own body. In fact, I've done things with the Geiger counter where the human body, anyone's body, is radioactive above background. So in fact, let me try it with my Geiger counter. Any excuse for me to get out my Geiger counter. You can tell if someone is a real geek if they're dying for any excuse to pull out their Geiger counter. let me get my Geiger counter. I'll find out for you. Yeah. Alrighty. Love my Geiger counter. Just let it warm up. My Geiger counter has it's got a tube in it, and so it's just got to warm up a little bit. Open up the window, because my counter, it's an alpha, beta, gamma counter, and it will actually even detect x-rays, and so it's fairly wide spectrum. So what we're hearing now, that's just the background radiation. Each little click is an energized particle entering the tube, and it's very random. So that's what the background radiation sounds like. Let's see what I sound like. See? But the human body is slightly above background. Because of all the radioactive isotopes that we have, potassium, carbon, blah blah blah. Not highly radioactive, but above background. That being said, neutrinos come from the deaths of stars. When a star goes supernova, the vast majority of all of its energy, it's like, I don't know, 95-98% or some, like almost all the energy that's released from the star is in the form of neutrinos. So the galaxy is just, it's awash in neutrinos. And neutrinos are so highly energized, they will go through the whole Earth, you know. Okay, so radiation aside, there are lots of reasons why our genetic material is at risk from all kinds of high energy particles. And because we are exposed to radiation all the time, and all life on Earth has always been exposed to radiation all the time, occasionally, every now and then, a highly energetic particle will bang into a part of a DNA strand with enough energy to knock a chunk out of it and make a change. And we get a mutation. But there are lots of other reasons for mutation other than radiation. In fact, most mutations occur simply because of cellular mitosis. Just because cells have to reproduce, and every time that a cell reproduces, it goes into action, reproducing a version of itself, replicating its DNA using proteins and such. It's a very fascinating process. I encourage you to read up on it. But the simple process of cellular division, there are so many places where a mutation can happen just from the process of cellular division that every living thing, you included and me included, has cells that have mutations that cause the cells to be damaged. And when cells are damaged in a way in which they will replicate uncontrollably, forms of that we call cancer. But we always have these precancerous cells in our bodies all the time. So why don't we all die of cancer before we even get to be adults? Well, the reason is our immune system is always on patrol. Our immune system, our macrophages, they are constantly patrolling our bodies looking for things that look foreign. And almost all the time, almost always, a cell that is mutated is seen as an enemy invader and it is consumed. Almost always. But we get cancer when a sequence of events, a long sequence of events, from mutation to cell division of that mutated cell, and that cell has to have an error that actually makes a cell different enough that it's recognized by our immune system as being a foreign object, and then our immune system takes it out. We get cancer when multiple systems break down. It's not just having the mutation. It's also that the immune system doesn't detect that or doesn't recognize that cell as being a foreign body and just lets it be. And then it just starts to grow out of control unchecked by our own immune system. Which is why a lot of the cutting edge cancer treatments have to do with programming the immune system to find the cancer cells and destroy them. That's where gene therapy is really the cutting edge, the idea being that if you can sequence the cancer cell and create a chemical signature that you can inject antibodies into the human body to get the immune system to actually attack the cancer like it's supposed to and destroy it like if it were a bacterium, that's really the kind of the future of cancer therapy. So cancer is a disease with lots of things that have to go wrong in the body to get it. But the idea that radiation causes cancer, it's not a direct link. Radiation, depending on the type of radiation and your dose, can create an awful lot of damage to your genetic material. It doesn't necessarily give you cancer. In fact, lots of people weirdly survived Hiroshima and Nagasaki, terribly burned, horribly irradiated, but they didn't die of cancer right away, and some of them surprisingly lived into their 90s. And Chernobyl was another thing where so many people died very, very quickly from radiation, but some people who got burned and exposed to high levels of radiation weirdly didn't die right away, lived you know, a surprisingly long time. There's just, yeah. there's no direct link between one to the other. But I'm not a doctor, so I really don't know anything about this kind of stuff. So, but that's my answer. Take it or leave it. But don't fear the Reaper. Okay, that's it for this one. Thanks for watching. Thanks to everyone on the Patreon. Making all these videos possible. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Everyone on Patreon. All right. I'm Fran. I'll be back here with a few more questions before I've got some stuff I want to get into. Yeah, I got another page of hard questions. So So maybe one more video in this series, and then I'm going to get back to the stuff, the usual stuff. All right. Okay, that's it. Bye!
Berserk in my lab. It's where I work. Watching Fran Lab. It's what I'm doing. Working at the bench again. I'm Fran.